Welcome back from the break. We are still discussing the impact of physical violence, emotional violence, and sexual violence this has on children. And with me is Peter Bahemuka. Peter is a senior programs officer with Raising Voices, and we are glad you chose us today. Now, Peter and I have been looking at how you and I, he and the rest, can, you know, look out, be vigilant, and try to realize that children, is this child okay? Are they being violated? Who is doing ABCD? How can I be of help? So yes, I went to social media and asked you guys to, I'm saying, as we continue the conversation on mental health, how does sexual violence, physical violence, and emotional violence against children affect them? Yes, now Angela here says it shreds one to pieces. However, there is hope for recovery. The Bible is a powerful healing tool. Words of affirmation like "you are fearfully and wonderfully made" are powerful in restoring self-esteem. Therapy through counseling and sometimes medication also help on the road to recovery. It is possible. It is a process, but healing is possible if the victim is determined to fight back by rejecting the abuse and its hallowing effects. Mandy says, children who are exposed to any form of violence suffer significant emotional and psychological trauma. This may be characterized by self-blame, depression, withdrawal, nightmares, fear, grief, poor or no concentration at school, and are likely to end up attempting suicide. Violence against children is another silent killer. Ronald says this is a... well, I used a picture of somebody, you know, trying to... I think it was showing violence against children. And somebody says this is a very sudden picture. Indeed it is. Gloria says, no child should ever go through this. It's a very dark, sad place. You get lost in your own mind. Unfortunately, everyone will miss it. This psychological torture is the worst there is. Only God and His grace can help someone who has gone through this as a child. The pain is unexplainable. May God be with anyone struggling with these dark memories, and may He protect every little child out there who needs help. These things are kind of getting me emotional. There are quite a number, but we have picked out those. So someone mentions that there's depression involved, that there is trauma, there is a lot of things. Is that all?
It is. Mm-hmm. It is true. Mm-hmm. And then sometimes it is a combination. So you have a combination of low self-esteem, depression,
yes,
you know, withdrawal. And then sometimes children also become aggressive, because that's the only way they can, you know, navigate the world around them. Mm. And then sometimes if we don't respond and, mm-hmm, you know, and act to help a child, you know, they go downhill, like, you know, become develop suicidal thoughts.
Yeah.
Now you were asking how else we could also intervene.
Mm.
Even adopting positive language can help.
By positive language, what do you mean?
Yeah, for example, when we call a child a victim, aren't we victimizing them the more? But if we say it's survivor, you know, there's a difference between a victim and a survivor. Is empowering.
Yes.
You know, as a survivor, I'm being encouraged.
Mm-hmm.
But as a victim, people are saying, I pity. Whereas if I say, look, you know,
you are
a survivor, you have overcome. You can overcome. You can even be better.
Yes.
You know, we are affirming.
Yes.
And so positive language is also a critical, because you remember they go through a lot of verbal abuse.
Yes, Peter, now that you talk about that, when they are in homes and they're being physically abused, How do I come in to have positive, you know, use positive language around them?
And once we know that they have been abused,
right,
in the state of helping them recover,
right,
that's where positive language becomes quite critical.
Yes,
because if we continue to say the victim,
oh, yeah,
then in a way it keeps them in that state. Whereas if it is a survivor, it gives them opportunity to now say, oh, okay.
I
can overcome.
Yes.
You know, therefore I want to do this.
It gives them confidence.
You know, the confidence levels go up.
Mm-hmm.
The affirmation helps them now realize, actually, I could have gone that through that, but it's not a permanent state for me.
Mm-hmm.
I can be a better person.
Right.
I will not use violence because I know how bad it is.
Mm.
And so that is, for me, is a critical element in helping people recover.
Mm.
As Raising Voices, we do have a program that we implement in schools. It's called the Good School program, the Good School concept. The Good School is not a school that has fancy buildings.
Okay.
Fancy buildings are important, they're nice. A green compound is important for play and also for learning purposes, but a good school is a psychological environment as well as physical environment that enables children to exercise their agency, to love their school, to
love
enjoy
themselves.
Learning, to love themselves,
yes,
to love their teachers, because the good school, we have a good school toolkit, helps a school create that environment that changes the operational culture. Now, today, the operational culture is that violence is acceptable.
Mm.
You did something wrong, go to the staff room for 10 strokes of the cane.
Yeah.
You did something wrong, go bring your father.
Mm.
And so, these harsh measures don't help children enjoy school.
Absolutely.
Or, because if teachers use corporal punishment, students start nicknaming them, they start calling them all sorts of names.
Yeah, we did that.
We start avoiding. When a teacher is coming that way, I cut.
You run for your life.
Yeah, I run for dear life.
Mm.
And so when we change the operational culture of a school from one that accepts violence to one that says, no, violence is something we don't tolerate.
Yes.
But everybody has to be committed.
True.
The teachers have to be committed to creating that good school.
Mm-hmm.
The head teacher has to be committed. The non-teaching staff, sometimes we forget them.
Mm.
The cook.
Yes.
The sweeper, you know, that admin clerk. The gatekeeper, they are also potential abusers, but they also have a role to play in creating a good school. Then the community, but most important of all, the child.
Yes.
Does the child participate in activities that empower them, that give them a voice? And so that is something we are implementing in school.
Mm.
And I can tell you that we have seen that it has positive impact on how children identify with their school.
Right.
We found that 50% of the children, when we implemented a randomized control trial in Luwero, in 42 schools. So in 21 schools, we were implementing the Good School Toolkit, and in 21, we were not, you know, it was the control group. But in the implementation schools, we found that 50% of the children enjoyed identifying with their school.
Right.
And then corporal punishment, teachers using corporal punishment, physical violence, had gone down by 42% in 18 months. And so just imagine if all this was done across the country. The benefits, the potential benefits we would get. And so that is one program, but there are other interventions.
Yes.
The World Health Organization has put together a package of interventions from across the world that can be used to prevent violence against children, but also respond.
Mm.
Primary prevention is the best strategy to invest in, because there we are kind of like stopping it before it happens.
Absolutely.
So we are doing all that needs to be done, education,
yeah,
capacity building, awareness creation, empowering children, so that it doesn't happen.
Mm.
But when it happens, we also need to respond, because if a child has been defiled, we can't say, oh, for us, we are for prevention, but this child needs immediate help,
right?
You know, to be supported. So the World Health Organization has put together what is called the Inspire Package. The Inspire Package has 7 strategies that can be used. So every letter in the word Inspire has what it, you know, it talks about. For example, I
stands for
implementing laws,
okay,
and policies. Mm-hmm. And so, like we were talking about the laws that we have, we should implement the laws.
Mm.
Then N is the norms, you know, norms and values, the things that we have come to accept as normal.
Yes,
we need to change them. Like, for example, accepting that corporal punishment is okay, or pursuing a girl persistently.
A little girl,
even a woman, a man pursues you. Society looks at it as, well, that is kind of like courtship.
Mm-mm.
You know, that's how it starts. No, but at what point do we appreciate from the woman's side that actually this is harassment, this is stalking, this is unwanted attention.
Mm.
And then so all the letters, I'll share with you.
Yeah, you'll share with me.
All the letters say. And so the Good School Toolkit is in the education and life skills.
My producer is signaling me that we need to, you know, end the show.
Yes. So there's light at the end of the tunnel.
Try it.
But, you know, one thing I must warn our colleagues and brothers and sisters, people who are watching us, the children who are watching us, preventing violence against children is not a one-off. You don't put in place laws and everybody complies. No, put in place laws, implement them, keep an eye and an ear to the ground.
Yes.
If somebody goes wrong, we deal with them. We should never cease to talk about it. Whenever you create time, invite us so that we come and talk about it. Because sometimes people think, but for me, I don't beat my children. I feed my children well. But if you don't create time for them to learn from you, you are not helping them.
Absolutely.
You're giving them food, you're giving them shelter, but you're not helping them negotiate the world in a better way. And so if we deny our children time, we wake up one day, we realize, oh, our children are pregnant, they are drug abusers, they don't sleep in the home, they are violent at school, because we have turned a back on them. So children need our attention. And so part of preventing violence against children is creating healthy relationships between adults and the children.
Wow, amazing. Thank you so much, Peter.
You're welcome, Lynn.
It has been an amazing subject discussion, but then I think we need some more time, yeah? Thank
yes,
you so much for joining us. Those of you who are watching from home, in and around, thank you very much. We'll catch you next Sunday. Please make time for your children. Sometimes all you need to know about your children is just sitting with them. Yeah.
Regularly.
Yes, have some time with them. We'll catch you next Sunday. God bless you.